La pobreza energética es un problema social creciente en Europa. Ante el incremento de hogares con dificultades, la Unión Europea ha mostrado una voluntad unánime de defender los derechos energéticos básicos. Pero, ¿qué han hecho hasta ahora los países? Un informe impulsado por la Fundación Naturgy y elaborado por la Cátedra de Sostenibilidad Energética de la Universidad de Barcelona y adscrita al Instituto de Economía de Barcelona, el IEB, analiza en profundidad las medidas implementadas en 5 países europeos. Alemania, España, Portugal, Francia y Reino Unido. En términos generales, la pobreza energética es entendida como aquella situación en la que se encuentra un hogar que no puede acceder a una cantidad de servicios energéticos suficientes para una vida digna y a precios razonables. A pesar del progreso realizado con la creación del Observatorio Europeo de la Pobreza Energética, es necesario avanzar en la homogeneización de la definición y cuantificación de la pobreza energética, criterios que continúan siendo dispares entre países.
En Europa, identificamos que 50 millones de hogares pobres energéticamente. Esos 50 millones seguramente deberían añadirse unos cuantos millones más de familias que no dan información sobre su situación y que están viviendo en situaciones de gran vulnerabilidad y de falta de confort.
Los países afrontan el problema tanto con medidas de ingresos puntuales que consiguen un impacto a corto plazo, como con medidas que aportan soluciones estructurales a través de políticas de gasto y conductuales, con repercusión a medio y largo plazo. En el estudio se recomienda apostar por estas últimas.
Existen diferentes naturalezas de medidas y no todos los países las aplican de la misma forma. Las de ingresos son las que ayudan a obtener una mayor renta disponible de las familias. Las medidas de gasto son aquellas que ayudan a reducir costes directamente, y las de conductas, las que informan y enseñan a los consumidores cómo deben no pagar una factura excesiva.
Estas iniciativas deberían, además, incorporar consideraciones medioambientales vinculadas al objetivo de descarbonizar Europa en 2050, siempre sin suponer una carga para los hogares más vulnerables. El informe también aconseja simplificar los procesos administrativos de solicitud de ayudas y fomentar la colaboración público-privada en los programas contra la pobreza energética.
La COVID supone un empobrecimiento de todos y, por lo tanto, una peor situación de las familias vulnerables. Pensemos que esto además afecta a la salud. El no tener una temperatura adecuada en el hogar supone un aumento de las enfermedades y algunas de ellas enfermedades ya permanentes.
La Unión Europea emprendió hace ya años el camino en la lucha contra la pobreza energética y el Pacto Verde Europeo apuesta por soluciones a largo plazo, incluso a pesar de las consecuencias devastadoras de la pandemia en las economías europeas. Una de sus recomendaciones centrales es priorizar la rehabilitación energética de las viviendas, una medida que ayuda a las familias a reducir su factura de suministros y, a la vez, colabora en la lucha contra el cambio climático.
Good morning, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank all those of you who have connected today. We have more than 400 people connected remotely. This webinar has been organized jointly with the Energy Sustainability Department of the University of Barcelona and the Naturgy Foundation. Our aim is to present a report prepared by the foundation that it contains a comparative analysis concerning energy poverty in Europe, so we will be trying to address several questions. So this report was authored by Maria Teresa Costa Campi, Elisa Tujino Bajusi. They are all professors at this Energy Sustainability Department of the University of Barcelona. In addition to this announcement, we will have a number of roundtables in order to provide some context as to the European vision and the challenges and all the work at hand. And then there will be a second roundtable where we will start talking about the national strategies that have been put in place by European countries in order to fight against energy poverty. The keynote speakers that will be connecting and joining us from Germany, Portugal, France, and the UK, and also in Spain, we have a direct connection between Madrid and Barcelona, so let's trust technology, and we hope that everything will run smoothly. So please bear in mind that this session will be translated simultaneously both into Spanish and English. So on your device screens, you have a tab in order to select the language channel that you want to use. That's all for the time being. Now let me welcome Mr. Francisco Reynés, who is the executive chairman of Naturgy. I would like to thank him especially for joining us today.
Thank you, Maria Eugenia. I'd like to thank everyone who has decided today to connect remotely to the session organized by the Foundation. The current times are forcing us to do these kind of meetings remotely, and I'm sure that technology will be on our side. Let's hope so, even though obviously this would have been, it would have been nicer to have this seminar live and meet face to face. But our commitment to help tackle this problem with the second outbreak is forcing us to do it this way, remotely. So first of all, I'd like to highlight that today we are presenting the third study in this webinar for a collaboration that has now become a special collaboration, very fruitful regarding the information that it renders through the collaboration of the Naturgy Foundation with the Chair of Energy Sustainability, and in particular I'd like to thank Maite Costa, Director of the Chair and Professor of Economy at the University of Barcelona, for her participation in the seminar, and mainly for managing this report. The report shows many things. It reveals mainly objective information that is essential to make decisions. In a world where we often make uninformed decisions, I think that the Chair of Energy Sustainability and the Foundation are now highlighting the fact that we can make decisions based on information that is well produced, well treated, and based on accurate conclusions to begin acting. Knowing is the first step before making decisions, and here the Chair and the Foundation have been able to work together very closely to make this information the basis to make decisions. So what do we need to do after that, and what is the objective of the Foundation? Well, promoting action. The fact that nowadays we are before a comparative study with five countries of the European Union is showing much more credibility and is giving us a wider perspective. How do other countries face problems? And how do these problems appear in certain areas of society? That's essential so that administrations and governments, society at large, and companies in particular, commit to look for solutions. The pandemic has shown the best of some companies, in particular energy companies, and mainly Naturgy. We have been very close to all groups that have, or may have suffered somehow some sort of effect after the pandemic. And it has also shown not just a friendly face, but also the human face of companies. In this regard, and thanks to reports such as today's report, we'll be able to express our commitment based on essential data. Talking about restructuring and improving energy efficiency in buildings, and talking about the problem that about 70% of homes have to reach comfortable temperatures in their homes, now that we're facing the harshest climate in winter. These are topics that, of course, we need to approach. And here the Foundation is willing to disseminate information, and Naturgy will also be looking for solutions to all these problems. Maite Costa will explain in detail the conclusions of the chair report in the Foundation, managed by Eugenia Coronado, who's here with me, will make that this report will not just be a publication, but rather a starting point for a great action plan. So I'd like to thank the Foundation again for allowing these actions to have a tangible effect. And I thank again the chair of Energy Sustainability to allow us to put objectivity and data to problems that are there and that we need to solve. And from Naturgy, of course, in both entities, you'll find full support for this kind of work.
Thank you very much. So we therefore undertake the mission that we have to carry out in order to find sustainable solutions in order to make progress in solving this issue. Now, I would like to say that Teresa Rivera, who is responsible for the Ministry of Ecological Transition and Demographic Challenge, is not able to join us today. We know that she would have liked to be here, but unfortunately she had other matters to attend to. So on behalf of her, we have another subject matter expert, Mr. Jacobo Llerena, who is the Deputy Director of the Ministry of Ecological Transition and Demographic Challenge. So we would like to welcome you, Mr. Llerena. You have the floor.
Buenos dias.
Thank you, and good morning. Thank you very much for inviting me. I'd like to thank the Executive President of Naturgy, Mr. Francisco Reynés, as well as the Director of the Foundation, Maria Eugenia Coronado. I'd like to thank you for this opportunity to allow me to participate in this webinar on measures against energy poverty in Europe. First of all, I'd like to express a few words that could be summed up in the current context regarding the objectives we have to combat energy poverty. And I'd like to relate that to energy transition and the fight against energy poverty, and also talk about the regulatory framework and the challenges we have ahead of us. I really enjoyed hearing the executive president of Naturgy regarding the energy rehabilitation of buildings, and I'll detail next. And in the current context, both domestic and international, I'd like to begin referring to the sustainable goal number 7 for clean and non-polluting energy. We're all aware of that, and we all know about that goal. And thanks to different studies, like the one we are presenting today, and through the energy poverty book in Europe that report has been made by the chair of Energy Sustainability and the Naturgy Foundation, and that allows us to reach the goals that we have in the short term and the long term: improving renewable energies, improving energy efficiency, and to sum up, energy supply is something essential to guarantee a dignified life and a good level of health for citizens. So first of all, I'd like to give you a cross-sectional perspective, 360 degrees, that is also inclusive. And here we're coordinating and relating regulatory elements, financing elements that you already know, and those technical, architectural, and habitability or living conditions for homes, such as rehabilitation of buildings, that is often needed for the groups we try to help, which are vulnerable consumers or severely vulnerable consumers. When we get to know about these topics, as I've mentioned with some of you, to be technical and rigorous, we get the concept and we use the concept of vulnerable consumer, but I'd like to insist on the personal side of this public policy. It is not just public, thanks to that public-private partnership, it's a task for everyone, for the whole society, both for governments, NGOs, third sector entities, all administrations involved, autonomous communities and regions, local entities. It really affects us all. And the vulnerable consumer is a person who is seeing precarious conditions regarding essential energy supply and regarding economic poverty in general. In this context, I'd like to refer to something that has to do with the European Union and then something domestic. In the European Union, we know about the Clean Energy Measures Package for all Europeans, published recently by the European Union, that includes the democratization of energy. And that will definitely alleviate that phenomenon of energy poverty. And regarding knowledge and data, the Observatory for Energy Poverty is quite interesting and important, and they estimate that 50 million homes in Europe are in energy poverty. And related to that, we need to put the consumer in the center, mainly talking about renewable energies, efficiencies, and we know about that. We know about the strategy. And they cannot actually meet the basic need of the energy supplies as a consequence of a different set of measures. But this context is aggravated due to the health crisis and the economic crisis. Therefore, energy supplies are essential. And that's why I would like to relate that with energy transition and the fight against energy poverty. When we talk about energy transition from the ministry and the government, we focus on decarbonization, electrification of the economy, and also to have a more green, sustainable and inclusive model that should be at the core of everything. And the introduction of renewable energies will be essential, but also the self-consumption schemes, the energy communities, to mitigate energy poverty and increase independence in energy consumption. And there's an example that I would like to talk about, which is the rehabilitation of buildings as energy hubs. Let's think about it. From the external elements of the facade, including technical security, and then thermal isolation with heat pumps, and the integration of renewable energies for self-consumption. Also digitization of home appliances and storage abilities through charging points or parking lots. And all that technical improvement needs to be put at the service of vulnerable consumers who may be in situations of energy poverty, not just due to a lack of resources, but also due to a lack of efficiency that they suffer often. So I do encourage you to have not just a short-term perspective that we do have, and from the administration we're working with different elements, the regulatory and financial, you know about the social bonds, the electrical one and the thermal one, and we need a long-term view to alleviate those structural elements that avoid that situation of energy poverty. That's why energy efficiency in the residential sector is essential. That's essential with all the European plan and aligned with all the European plans. And of course, we need to inform and communicate, hence this report, and also with other measures that may be smart, such as the sensors for energy poverty. And that's a good example of the public-private partnership that we have in the public sector and companies and associations and NGOs that participate in this area. So I think that this collaboration and these consultancies will allow us to invest smartly the public budget. Regarding the regulatory framework, we know about it quite well. There have been quite a few initiatives, regulatory, economic. I'll mention the European plan for energy and climate. And for the next few years, we have some measures for necessary action, palliative measures in the short term and structural measures in the long term. And the strategy establishes four important indicators to set parameters and have traceability on this, to look for heating energy poverty, look at the appropriate temperature or bills and arrears. And from the ministry, we're elaborating with the collaboration of the sector the first draft of the operational plan to implement these measures, including the strategy. And all governments are collaborating with that. And from the beginning of the pandemic, a new category of beneficiaries of the social bond has been created, and other external measures have been created as well. Even some important news have been the access to that subsidy. And to sum up and finish, I'd like to mention a few ideas I have already expressed. First of all, the long-term focus. We need to take that into account, and I know we are taking it, but we need to apply rationality and knowledge so that this course of structural measures may avoid energy poverty. And we also need smart financing. The government is doing that, but we need to measure, we need to certify, and we need to assess actions, both before and after, to look at the evolution of the energy performance and where it's important to act in home elements. And there, training is essential. We talked about energy poverty advisors, and we need to train, and they're doing a good task, even though the regulation is not clear. And also we need to look for complementary solutions in the public and private spheres. And there's a current debate, which are the tax bonuses to avoid a possible loss for the wealth increase due to the subsidies. And then creativity and innovation to inform and get to know the situation of neighborhoods and cities who are in energy poverty. Thank you very much again, and it's a pleasure to participate in this webinar.
Jacobo, thank you very much for your address. You walked us through the different regulations that are not being studied and that are being implemented. Therefore, we know what direction we can take jointly with third sector stakeholders, government representatives, in order to realize all these projects that you have shared with us. So thank you once again for joining us today. Well, now we are going to go straight into the first roundtable titled Vision of Energy Poverty in Europe. During the first roundtable, in addition to analyzing the findings contained in this report we commented before, we will address the evolution of measures with regards to energy poverty in the EC, challenges ahead, and also the roadblocks in implementing some measures. So as the president said, and before I give the floor to Maria Teresa and Stefan, we should provide a short introduction or share with you our interest from the perspective of the Naturgy Foundation. At the foundation, we are highly committed to all those activities that may enable us to make effective progress in fighting against energy poverty. We use different approaches, and in most cases, these are highly operational approaches that are tied to building retrofit as well as training and consultancy on energy poverty related matters. We have been working on these matters for a long time. We do not do this alone. We work hand in hand with social institutions, governments, energy volunteers that make a daily contribution in finding solutions that, well, they can manage within the time they can afford. But not only that, we want to make another contribution. We believe that these studies are highly valuable because they provide us with some reliable information, information that has been verified and that can be very useful for those who are responsible for decision making or who have to find the best alternatives to make progress. So that's the ultimate goal of the training work that we carry out in order to supplement our operational work. In the specific case of this report and through this discussion, we would like to open the floor in order to share experiences and the strategies applied by different countries and the difficulties they have faced in implementing some of these measures. So after this introduction, let me now first, give the floor to Ms. Maria Teresa Costa Campi, who will throw some light at the contents of this report. So Maria Teresa is a professor at the Chair of Energy Sustainability at the University of Barcelona. She's also a researcher at the Institute of Economics of Barcelona, former president of the National Energy Commission, and former president of the Commission of Energy Regulators. She authored more than 100 books internationally and nationally, and more than 65 articles published in well-renowned international journals. In February 2019, she received the Energy and Society Prize as a result of her vast professional experience and her contribution to the energy sector. So welcome, Maite, you have the floor. Thank you so much, Maria Eugenia, for such a kind introduction. And thank you to the Naturgy Foundation and the University of Barcelona, which through a number of agreements makes it possible for the Energy Sustainable Department to address such an important topic as energy poverty by introducing our own academic research criteria. So no doubt this has been a very interesting challenge, being able to analyze and what other countries are doing to face energy poverty and make proposals accordingly. Energy poverty is not actually limited to a single jurisdiction. Virtually all countries to a greater or lower extent have an energy poverty situation that no doubt affects specific vulnerable groups or this is what we have tried to do through this report. I hope that you can see it on the screen. So we are going to introduce five topics. We will talk about the purpose of the study structure, the comparative analysis. We will provide some recommendations. This is a decalogue of recommendations included at the very end. And then we will also make a number of considerations as to the urgent measures that have been applied as a result of the COVID-19 impact on our lives and economies. So what have countries done in order to try to help to solve the issue of energy poverty? This is a right, being able to access energy services is a right, and European regulations state so. Now, how can we guarantee access to such rights when people's income may actually compromise the cost of the service supply. That's therefore the purpose of the study, carrying out a comparative analysis of the main measures taken in order to fight against energy poverty in five countries in Germany, Spain, France, Portugal, and the UK, respectively. So through this study, we intend to support those measures that could better address the issue of how they are being implemented in each country, taking into account that so far this study has not considered the effectiveness impact that it might have, something that will have to be done after the completion of the first study. Of course, this is not the first study conducted by the Naturgy Foundation, but rather within the scope of this comparative analysis with other European countries. Now, energy poverty is outside of the scope of institutional frameworks at an international level. This is a question, and the answer is no. On the one hand, we have the Declaration of Human Rights. We also have the Declaration of Social and Cultural Rights, and then the ODS, or SDGs in English, which is the backbone of all the decisions that are made with regards to energy and climate, apart from other social and economic fields. At a European level, we have the Clean Energy for All Europeans package that addresses the issue of energy poverty through different directives, and let me point out two of them. One on energy efficiency that plays a very important role as it serves as an instrument for the medium and long term to solve the problem of energy poverty. And then another directive on the domestic market in the electricity context. So this is concerned with another instrument that should be deemed as an exceptional one, because here we are talking about tariffs or prices. And just recently, in October, on the 14th of October, the EC also made a statement about energy poverty, providing recommendations, and also spoke about retrofitting buildings or dwellings across Europe so that energy poverty can become a goal in itself and also a goal in order to solve the energy poverty problem. Then the EU Energy Poverty Observatory, I believe that the next speaker will touch upon this topic, and finally the European Green Deal. At a national level, and Spain is one of the countries that over the past years has taken the greatest number of actions in order to fight against energy poverty. We have a national energy and climate plan, and also the national integrated energy and climate plan. Where can actions can be taken in order to address energy poverty? Well, we can talk about income, expenditure, or behaviors. As for income, what's the goal here? Well, the household's income should be enough in order to pay electricity bills or gas bills, so that people have what we call heat comfort at home. So, on the one hand, we're talking about financial actions, for example, providing social bonds, like in the case of Spain or Portugal, or the so-called energy checks in France. We also have some protection measures, which are also framed by the European directive, that is to say, to avoid unreported interruption of energy supply to fuel-poor households. This instrument has been particularly important, and it's part of the policies being applied in order to solve the impact caused by COVID-19, if not fully, at least partially. Also, to provide grace periods for late payments. Let me mention something that is concerned with the temporary impact of these measures concerning income. Usually these are short-term measures in order to solve an urgent problem, an immediate problem. That means that if the fundamentals of energy poverty are not solved, that should be a permanent commitment. Therefore, this is a policy whereby, unless we solve the underlying problem, or this policy might be costly. And there are two main aspects that account for energy poverty: poverty in itself, but then energy poverty also has other aspects that make it necessary to apply certain instruments, and in connection with energy poverty, people's incapacity in order to solve a key problem, which is energy efficiency. So solving this matter means that medium and long-term objectives should be attained. Therefore, energy efficiency is the very backbone of policies in order to address energy poverty. There are different solutions that are deployed across Europe through by covering energy expenses, and all this arises from energy efficiency measures. For example, this is one of the goals of thermal rehabilitation. Then there are other measures that are also implemented across countries, and this has to do with informing customers as to how they should use energy so that users do not overuse energy, therefore bearing very high costs when paying their electricity bills. That is a single, is there a single indicator to assess how we are standing or where we are standing? The answer is no. As you can see on the screen, if we take a look at the different indicators reported here, whether the poverty percentage who incurred late payments, or the population who say that have their houses at inadequate heat levels, or those who do not have the necessary income, or those whose population, or who have a percentage of population that are subject to what we call hidden energy poverty, or HEP. That shows, therefore, this is the heat map for Europe. This means, therefore, that we need to make an effort in finding some kind of harmonization to really decide how we will face energy poverty. Let me pick up the two indicators that talk about the percentage of households with very high energy costs vis-a-vis their income. Here we are talking about low income, high cost, or LIHC, or the MIS group. That is to say, those households who are suffering some heat comfort problems and who are therefore forced to reduce heating conditions due to their poverty circumstances. We analyzed all the countries that you see on the screen. We tried to see what each country does, and afterwards we drew a comparative analysis. So we studied how countries implement energy poverty programs over time. This is something that started out in the UK. UK is the forerunner in launching energy poverty fighting measures, and also the pioneer from a scientific and academic perspective. So countries are trying to solve these problems in the short term by using income instruments, or in the medium or long term by applying other instruments aimed at solving energy poverty or teaching consumers how we should use electricity and gas. Another highlight, we have analyzed how these instruments are developed. If they are misdeveloped, it's of no use, or they are of no use at all to fight against energy poverty. This should actually benefit people, and we should have, or we should understand what goal are we trying to attain in order to benefit people. Here we are talking mainly about fuel poor households. We also need a straight and understandable administrative procedure in place, because if the procedure is too complex, we should bear in mind that vulnerable households, as shown in prior studies, are usually households with a very low educational level, with limited access to education. Therefore, for them, being able to understand the procedures is very important, but that's a pending issue. Now, looking forward, we need to eradicate energy poverty for all. This is tied to the evolution of the country's GDP. The GDP curve evolution and energy poverty match at some point. But on the other hand, we have energy efficiency, in addition to increasing, of course, employability and being able to earn more money through jobs. In addition to all this, we need to make sure that the energy efficiency of buildings and dwellings is solved. This is part of the package of measures to solve energy poverty, and that should be the key supporting point. How do we measure energy poverty? There are different indicators that you can see on the screen, and that are also contained in the annex to the recommendation drafted by the EC and published on October the 14th. This is a key goal, and the recommendation is precisely about that. These are the countries that we analyzed, and they all use the same indicators. Germany has not identified from a regulatory perspective the problem of energy poverty, or has not identified a specific policy to address this, because in Germany, energy poverty is tackled indirectly within the framework of the German poverty plan in overall. So there are only very few aspects directly concerned with energy poverty. In Spain, we have the indicators proposed by the EPOV, as well as the EU. France has its own indicators adapted to LIHC. Portugal does not have any official indicators, and the UK, for the specific case of England, they apply the LIHC approach, and in the case of Northern Ireland, Wales and Scotland, they use the MIS threshold of 10%. What about the evolution in all these countries? The first step, therefore, would be to address compelling problems, but as the energy poverty policies consolidate across Europe, we are moving towards structural measures that have to do with focusing on energy efficiency and energy behavior. In this case, the UK is the one that is positioned the best. So France is also fighting in this respect, and they have also developed very well-structured measures. Spain also has some measures in place to fight energy poverty. Spain, in particular, has some public-private programs in place, and it's within the framework of public and private collaboration where actions emerge in order to solve energy poverty in fuel-poor households. One of the problems that we find in energy efficiency programs is that they are normally aimed at addressing problems regardless of the income levels of the people living in those households. So we should find specific solutions for vulnerable groups, and in this case, the foundation has been working on this matter for a long time. So what about the Decalogue that we propose here? Well, first of all, we need that homogenization is critical in order to make progress towards a European policy that can take into account geographical specificities and also temperature differences, while also allowing us to carry out joint studies. We should also develop short and medium-term policies, enhanced coordination between public and private stakeholders, supporting energy communities in buildings in order to develop self-consumption policies, also being able to apply renewable energies programs and improving energy efficiency while obtaining increased income. Some countries do not include climate indicators. We believe that that should actually be reversed because it's fundamental. We should also identify fuel-poor households as part of these energy efficiency programs. We also need to prepare very simple administrative procedures, providing solutions through private stakeholders, for example, through distributors. Transmission companies are the perfect players in order to carry out the actions required to improve households' energy efficiency. The problem is a multifaceted one. It's multidimensional, and therefore we need all stakeholders to take an active role in implementing the programs. As for the measures that have been implemented with regards to COVID are the following. For example, anticipating the interruption of energy supply, also avoiding excessive grace periods that also affect transmission companies eventually, granting subsidies or rebates to companies, and then providing support to the vendors that take the surplus of their energy into the grid. So this is in summary, these are in summary the main contents of this report, and I don't want to take any more time because I believe that I went well beyond my time slot. Thank you. Thank you very much, Maite. In fact, it's very difficult to summarize such an in-depth report. I would like to say that you can download this report for free by entering the Foundation's website. There you can find all the information that Maite shared with us very quickly. Now we would like to give the floor to Stefan Buzarowski, who will also talk about the evolution of energy poverty measures, and will also walk us through the main challenges, opportunities, and obstacles in this respect. Stefan is a teacher at the University of Manchester. He was also director of the EU Energy Poverty Observatory. He is chairman of the Task Force Engagement, a European project bringing together professionals that are engaged in fighting energy poverty in order to obtain a transformational change in their lives. So Stefan's research is mainly focused on the intersection of energy geographies, social, spatial mismatches, and also the science of sustainability. Stefan, thank you very much for joining us today. You have the floor.
Thank you. And can you hear me? I hope you can. It's a real pleasure to be here today. Interesting to hear the findings of your report, and also I'm delighted to see how well attended the event is. So as you mentioned before, I used to chair the EU Energy Poverty Observatory in its first phase. Otherwise, I am a researcher. I've been working in this field for over 20 years now in the field of energy poverty, trying to basically set a conceptual frame, but to study the problem, but also provide evidence about it. So I'm just going to show my presentation on the screen. I will talk about some of the main policy developments and challenges that we currently face at the EU level, and indeed how some of them have been explored by the EU Energy Poverty Observatory, some of the reports published recently by the observatory, and also where we might be going in the future. So very briefly, the mention of this idea of energy poverty isn't new. We've had it in official documentation since 2009, in the third energy package, in the directives that accompanied that set of legislative provisions. Then with the European Economic and Social Committee, which has always been at the forefront of these discussions, we had calls from an observatory, a number of debates. We had a vulnerable consumer working group in the European Commission. We had lots of work by the European Parliament, also in the Committee of the Regions and so on. So various EU institutions started to get interested in this, and also institutions outside of, or organizations outside of, let's say, the legal and policy framework of the actual EU. So things like non-governmental organizations, lobby groups, and so on. We now have a really broad network of stakeholders that are active on this subject because it's just been recognized that it's a structural obstacle on the way to a low carbon transition. We've had major improvements in the monitoring, in the reporting, but also the understanding of the condition. And indeed, as was mentioned before by my colleague from the University of Barcelona, there is no single definition, nor is there a single indicator to measure this, partly because poverty itself is a question of social contracts. It is always a large part a relative condition that defines your ability to participate in society. So it's always a question of social norms and social expectations. What is the needed level of energy in a given society is a matter of sociocultural expectations, and therefore a large part of energy poverty, not all of it, but a large part, is a question of defining what those norms are in a given context. A part of energy poverty, however, is not, and this is important because living in a home that is very cold or very hot, and I would say also living in a home that's poorly lit and so on, can really impede your health, your mental well-being. So there is an element of energy poverty that goes into the domain of public health, and it's not just a question of social participation and well-being. So there's these two aspects of the problem, which make it difficult to pinpoint and define, and therefore you cannot have also one overarching other than a very general definition. You can't really have an overarching legal definition without getting into some very interesting political questions around what is needed, what's required, what is expected. The EU Energy Poverty Observatory which is now ended its first phase, a European Commission service, was, I would say, in its first phase, really focused on trying to grapple with some of these major methodological issues and also provide information on what energy poverty is, really give us an overview of some of the main indicators and how they vary. The EU Energy Poverty Observatory, as well as all this huge network of stakeholders, partly also the Engager Network, which I chair as well, has been working together with decision makers, particularly in the EU, to advise, but also to advocate for various other proposals that have come through. The main one, of course, were the clean energy package provisions that were adopted last year and mentioned before. And also recently, we've had the Green Deal, the renovation wave, which really put forward just transitions at its core. And recently, we also had the European Commission starting to formalize some of these EU clean energy package provision in some quite clear recommendations on what member states are expected to do. So we've come a really long way. When I started working on this 20 years ago, and I published a book in 2003, that was my first book, which used the term energy poverty, and then everyone was like, no, energy poverty is something that you have in sub-Saharan Africa, in the global south, in South America, in Asia. But I said, well, you can call what's happening in Europe also energy poverty, because there are many households in Europe who are struggling not just to pay but also to access energy. And here I would question, I think, the idea that energy poverty is a matter of education. I think it's primarily a matter of capital investment and housing stocks. Energy conservation among energy poor households is very difficult to achieve. It's not a matter really of changing behaviors, it's a matter of improving their living conditions and more broadly their access to justice. So it's the decision-making capacities and mechanisms that are failing, and they're failing across various levels of governance, but also it's also the structural issues that have been inherited from the past in the building stock. In my view, and I've worked again with thousands and thousands of energy poor households across Europe, they are very good at saving energy and they're very good at working with the limits of what they have. So I don't think they need further education on how to work with energy. However, they do need more capital investment, they need more support, they need better access to justice. So, very quickly about the EU Energy Poverty Observatory. It's been a very popular resource, and I'm sure now it's in second phase, it's going to grow further. It's got lots of visitors on the website, a huge public database with publications, with relevant policies, training resources. You can go to the website and see. We've published several pan-EU poverty, energy poverty reports. And we've provided lots of technical assistance. That was in the first phase. So here I would highlight two sets of documents published by the Observatory. One are the member state reports. You can find the link here. They give you headline statistics for each member state's policy measures, relevant organizations and practices. So you can really get a sense of what's happening there. And also, I would say it's the Pan-EU Energy Poverty Report. That was published earlier in the year. The report was a collaborative effort by several experts working in the field. It gives you an overview of EU policy developments, gives you analysis of national energy climate plans, measures to fight COVID-19 at the time, that was in June, and also various statistics at the EU level. One thing that we have in the report that may be of interest, this was my colleague Marine Cornelis was the lead author on this. She looked at how, based on criteria that we defined in the observatory, and these criteria are basically whether energy poverty is recognized, whether it's being addressed directly, what sort of policies happen are available in various member states, whether it's investment efficiency, social welfare, and so on. She looked at all of the national energy climate plans and evaluated them from that perspective, and that evaluation is in the report, so you can really see how different member states have in their national energy climate plans treated the question of energy poverty and how comprehensively they've addressed these criteria that we have defined. For the purposes of the analysis, of course, they are not legislative criteria or anything like that. And on that basis, I should say, particularly, I would highlight Belgium, Spain, and France as one of the leading countries in terms of having really good national energy climate plans in the domain of energy poverty. There's also in the report, you can find information on COVID-19 measures at the time, but you could see that even then, many countries, many member states were very actively thinking about how to address COVID-19, the challenges of COVID-19 in the context of energy poverty, because we know that the pandemic has really worsened the problem of energy poverty. There is a lot of evidence to show that. Now, what are some of the challenges moving forward? Well, we have lots of policies now, but we don't have many binding targets. It's all still very general in many domains, and I think it's a problem because we have a situation whereby you can still get away with defining or understanding energy poverty as a more vulnerability sort of questions and question and not a very specific issue that an issue of material deprivation that is not even, I mean, it's income poverty, but it's more than income poverty. It's really about the ability to secure energy in the home. So from that point of view, we have real challenges, I think, in terms of the definition of the problem and the understanding of the problem in many member states, where it's still kind of seen under the domain of social policy. And what is more, in social policy, there isn't enough of a recognition of this as a distinct issue. It's just put under the blanket of income poverty. But we know that you need separate measures for energy poverty. You need particularly housing and energy efficiency measures, infrastructural measures. So I think also we've got lots of policies at the local scale, at the national scale, to address this problem. And I think we don't have enough of an understanding of how much they really address the problem or how much they are, again, issues, efforts to address other issues but are being sold as energy poverty problems. And also some of the good ones aren't really showcased. So hopefully in the next phase but of the observatory, which is now going to be run by a different team, but nevertheless, I hope that group of organization will focus on that. But also more broadly, there's going to be a wider discussion of around what is best practice, how we can evaluate, how we can promote, how we can disseminate information around it. One other challenge, I think, across Europe is that we really have very different responses across member states, but also at the regional and the local level. Sometimes, and it's not sometimes, this is very frequently a result of very limited financial resources, very limited knowledge, very limited decision-making and implementation capacity and regulatory capacity as well. And so I think this is going to be a real challenge moving forward, because we're going to have different regions addressing their problems differently. And in the context of the transition, we could get deepening divisions. I wrote a paper several years ago called the European Energy Divide, where really on the question of energy justice and inequality, we have huge differences among EU member states. And that energy divide, I fear, might get worse under the low carbon transition or the renovation wave or whatever you might call it, because we might end up with some regions that are really good at this doing even better and getting all the money and investing. And even when there is investment, the investment might just go to those who don't necessarily need it, who are easier to access, the low hanging fruit, as it were, is a term that's often used. So that's all for me. I'm trying to keep within my time. So thank you very much for listening to me today.
Thank you very much, Stefan. Thank you, Maite. I believe that you have already provided us with a very useful conceptual framework in order to plunge into the next roundtable. We are a little bit tight on time, so we are going to turn to Madrid for the second round on national strategies against energy poverty, to be moderated by Ms. Esther Sevilla, who is the Social Projects Director at the Naturgy Foundation. You have the floor, Esther. Thank you very much, Maria Eugenia, and welcome all to this second roundtable on national strategies against energy poverty. Now we are going to be connecting with five keynote speakers on energy poverty who represent the countries involved in the study. Without any further ado, we're going to first give the floor to Ms. Andres Loschel, Professor of Economics at the University of Münster in Germany and an associate researcher at the Department of Energy Sustainability and one of the world key researchers in the area of energy sustainability. Since 2011, he has chaired the expert commissions called Energy for the Future in Germany for the supervision and transformation of energy. And currently, he is the main researcher of the Intergovernmental Group of Experts. Thank you very much, Andres, for joining us today and for sharing with us the German perspective on energy poverty and how you are tackling this issue in Germany. You have the floor.
Okay, thanks a lot for having me today. And thanks a lot for a brief introduction into the German policies framework on energy poverty. I think we have already heard quite some important general remarks by Stefan and by Maite. And Germany indeed is using relatively little targeted policies to address issues of energy poverty, but uses more a more comprehensive approach within the general framework of social security measures in Germany. I'm not sure whether you can see my slides. That was one thing I was not sure, and or how I can actually move you to this through the slides, but let me just describe that briefly verbally. So so we have in Germany, as I said, a lot of income-based policies. There is a relatively good social security system in Germany, and energy is part of these security systems. So we have some standard requirements for financial supports of households under the unemployment benefit schemes, under the social assistance schemes. In Germany, of course, there are always discussions whether these fixed payments are actually fully covering expenses and how fast they are actually changed in response to changes in costs of energy. But this is the general approach. There is as well something that's called housing benefits. So if you are under social security, then actually your heating expenses are directly covered, you know, by the government. So I would say the low income households that fall under social security are relatively well protected. Of course, the main problem that we found in many of the analysis is especially for individuals that are not just not falling under social security and are not therefore benefiting from any of these special treatments under the German social security system, and their energy poverty might be even a broader topic. Then we have additional measures on different levels. So, for example, we have tax bonus systems now for energy efficiency measures, mainly in the building sector, but there is as well possibility of getting cheap loans for energy efficiency. Of course, again, this is usually not addressing really low-income households, but as Stefan has already indicated, of course, these housing measures are really important because the living conditions are one of the key drivers of high energy costs as well in Germany. This is a discussion that's ongoing. There is as well a lot of information and training to low income households. That's probably the most directed approach in the German sphere. We have a lot of activities by consumer advocacy groups that provide free economic or legal advice, for example. And this is an issue that gains more more visibility as well in the policy sphere, probably more than it should be, besides these harder measures that are basically missing. There is, of course, as well a follow-up of these developments in the German policy discussions. So, for example, in the NECPs Germany has submitted, they are as well mentioning all these different issues. We are yearly publishing a monitoring report on the progress of the German energy transition. And in the monitoring report, we are as well monitoring the energy cost burden on households. As a proxy, we differentiate between low-income households and energy cost burdens by the average households. If you do that, you can see that indeed the low-income households are burdened more heavily proportionally. So we have energy costs of around 9-10% in Germany for low-income households, and that that is relatively stable in the last years. Of course, there is as well more in-depth analysis that as well shows that, well, there is a large overlap between more general poverty-related issues and the issues of energy poverty, but this overlap is not fully. We have as well done different analysis that look at issues, for example, of disconnection as a most extreme case of energy poverty. But I think in general, in the German system, I mean, you know, these national circumstances matters, as we have heard. So there is a relatively good and stable existing social security scheme with, well, I would say, solid general economic circumstances, and therefore this discussion is not so imminent in the German sphere. There is a discussion if new policies are implemented, and I think the most important example here is we have a new energy pricing scheme in the non ETS sector, so in heating and transport. And here you can see that this would, of course, be from a distributional perspective a quite difficult policy, because we think it's hitting a lot the polluters. It's as well going to hit hardest families that live in energy bad insulated houses. There are a lot of measures that have been implemented to counteract these distribution aspects. In general, there is a lot of opportunities to lower the burdens by redistributing incomes from these taxes. So carbon taxes, income from carbon taxes, they can be redistributed and can be targeted to actually address low-income households that are overproportionally burdened. I think that's something that has not been done sufficiently. And we as well ask the government in our monitoring to shift some of the more general burden of the energy transition to the general budget. So, for example, we have a large burden in electricity pricing coming from feed-in tariff support of the past. The German feed-in tariff system is really very expensive. We pay every year more than 25 billion euro, and this is redistributed via electricity prices. And therefore, it is, of course, regressive and overburdening low-income households. We ask the government to actually move these payments for the feed-in tariffs to the general budget, where you have, I would say, well, established mechanism to alleviate some of the negative distribution consequences. This is addressed in the by the government, but to our assessment, not fully. We would like to see this much more and think much more about how energy price reforms could really look like and how we can better address the issues with energy costs of low-income households. Thanks a lot.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much, Professor Loschlet. Thank you for such an interesting approach to the German case. Now we're going to travel back to Spain. As the second country contained in the report, we have Ms. Paula Santos Ortiz. She holds a degree in physics sciences from the University Complutense of Madrid, and she's a specialist in renewables, EUREC. So she has her professional career is tied to the chain value of renewables from production and manufacturing of parts at research labs all the way to project development. Over the past years, she specialized in getting to know the regulatory framework of renewables in Spain, as well as other key pillars for the economy decarbonization, such as energy efficiency, poverty, or energy efficiency. And right now, she works at the Ministry of Energy Transition. Thank you very much, Paula, for joining us today. So you hold the flag in the fight against energy poverty. So we are delighted to have you here to hear what you have to share with us. Thank you very much, Esther. And thank you also to the Naturgy Foundation for having me, and also for the work you perform with regards to energy poverty-related issues. As Esther said before, I'm part of the State Energy Secretariat. I work in the area of renewable energies and energy poverty, so thank you very much for having me. I believe that, several key points have already been presented, and the presentation of Maite's report has been most interesting. Without any further ado, let me talk about our national plan to fight against energy poverty, its fundamentals and its key pillars. Also, the Deputy Director of Energy Efficiency, who took the floor this morning, also provided you with some figures in this regard. So the National Poverty Energy Plan is one of the mandates of a royal decree in Spain, and this arises in times where energy policies are mainly concerned with transforming our energy system, decarbonization, and the electrification of the economy, and the use of demand and energy production. So this energy transition is very important because it takes citizen-centric approach and considers energy as a key fundamental right. So based on the current circumstances and the policies that we are developing at the ministry, it made all the sense of the world to start developing a national strategy defining for the very first time the phenomenon of energy poverty and efficiency. Maite has already talked about the importance of defining what energy poverty means, taking a step further. So that's the key purpose of this strategy that was published in April 2019 and will be valid until 2024. So it defines the phenomenon of energy poverty as the situation where households cannot afford heat in their homes. And then it takes another step further by characterizing the actions that should be taken in fighting against energy poverty by using a number of indicators that are based upon the EPOV standards and also based on a number of updates that are regularly published. So this national plan is also in line with other strategic plans that we are also publishing at the ecological transition ministry, we are also preparing some others. So energy poverty is a key component to the energy transformation that we are working on. The national strategy against energy poverty pursues the goal of fighting against energy poverty. Therefore, one of the goals is to reduce energy poverty by 25% by 2025. To this end, and in order to evaluate the impact objectively, the EPOF's indicators have been applied. In attaining this goal, the national strategy that we prepared also undertakes some additional commitments, such as, for example, some new measures or extending the periods before energy supply is interrupted, or also the introduction of energy efficiency measures for vulnerable households, as it has already been mentioned. Therefore, mechanisms have been put in place in order to inform vulnerable groups and the population at large in general. As Maite and Stefan have already mentioned in their presentations, the use of these indicators that may enable us to set parameters to characterize energy poverty evolution in each country is critical. For that reason, in Spain, we are using the indicators proposed by the EPOV. You are already familiar with those, in order to study the evolution of energy poverty in Spain, and also to analyze the importance and effectiveness of the government's measures in fighting against energy poverty. Every year, we publish an update of these indicators in order to render the evolution transparent, so that all citizens may be aware of how all the measures are performing, and also to give us a gist of the evolution provided by these indicators. This year, we are going to provide an update of the 2020 indicators that represent energy poverty results for 2019, and therefore they do not take into account the impact of COVID-19. We only include information from last year. This information is available to all citizens. It's available on the ministry's website, and I encourage you to consulted. So the main indicators came down by in 2019 vis-a-vis 2018, even though it is true that in the case of hidden energy poverty, and this is another indicator to analyze energy poverty, there are many other indicators that are still missing. There was some drop with regards to inadequate temperature in winter, or for example, electricity bill late payments. We tried to include all these components in the forthcoming updates of these indicators by adding some other variables. For example, people's activities, or the household's income, or the kind of rental dwelling being assessed. In all four cases, with regards to all four indicators, we found some additional variables such as unemployment, also low income, old buildings, and unheated properties. In all such cases, the indicators are much higher, so that shows that energy poverty is directly concerned with poverty and social exclusion. Therefore, it must be tackled by taking a cross-cutting approach with the involvement of all public and private stakeholders concerned. So I encourage you to take a look at this document. In closing, I understand that afterwards other panelists will touch upon this strategy further. This national strategy, or all the actions within the framework of this strategy, are based upon four pillars. The first pillar is focused on improving knowledge about energy poverty. In this regard, and as I mentioned before, we need to update energy poverty indicators in order to set up a robust monitoring system. We are already working on that, and we are rendering this publication of indicators transparent. The second pillar has to do with providing a better response to energy poverty. This includes measures, actions that are intended to provide short-term relief against energy poverty. As Jacobo and Maite already pointed out, in Spain, there are some subsidies in place, the electrical and the thermal bonds, respectively. In the future, we would like to provide additional assistance, also identifying what we need to improve to cover as many vulnerable groups as possible. Pillar three has to do with those actions that need to be developed and that tie directly into long-term measures and, energy poverty as a phenomenon. They are closely intertwined to improving energy efficiency in households, and this includes the indicators that we described before, because they have a great impact on energy poverty. And in closing my presentation, we have pillar four that includes protection and social awareness measures. So these protection measures are crucial in order to inform the population about energy efficiency and also to reach out to all consumers that may be within the vulnerable groups. So we need to develop the adequate information systems on the media, but we could also find energy mediators or advisors that can provide direct, full advice as to improved consumption habits, about the potential or the benefits of energy efficiency measures, and also other potential steps that these vulnerable groups could take. Where are we standing right now? The Deputy Director of Energy Efficiency already mentioned this. The national strategy includes the execution of at least one operational plan during the implementation of the strategy, and that's what we are working on right now. This operational plan will make it possible to go deeper into some of the measures included in the strategy and setting timeline. All this needs to be done in coordination with the local governments, third sector groups, and also with society at large. So thank you very much. Thank you very much, Paula, for your presentation and for sharing with us the approach of the national strategy. Afterwards, we're going to have some questions for you. Well, in traveling around countries included in the book, we now have Aude Dubois, professor at the International Business School, ISG, in Paris, France. She has a PhD in economics, and right now she is researching on public policies with regards to social aspects concerning energy consumption, with a particular focus on energy poverty policies. Furthermore, she has also been involved in energy-related policies, especially the energy market liberalization, market design, competition policies, and the effects of the energy market liberalization among small consumers. So thank you very much, Ute, for joining us today and for sharing with us how you address energy poverty in France. which provides some very good example as to tackle this issue, because you have measures in place since a long time. So we would like to hear firsthand how you deal with this in France.
Thank you. Thank you for having me here today. I'm going to talk about the French strategy against energy poverty, and my presentation will focus mainly on the national approach, so the approach of the national state. But of course, as France has been working on the topic of energy poverty for several years now, there are a lot of other approaches, which I will not mention in this presentation, but which are important as well, which are at the level of local authorities or which have been initiated by associations. There are research initiatives as well. So a lot of things are going on in the field of energy poverty in France. France has a definition of energy poverty since 2010. And in 2015, France, in its energy transition law, has defined an objective of reduction of energy poverty of 15% until 2020, as well as an objective of renovation of homes. So France wanted to renovate 500,000 homes per year, out of which 50% should be homes of the low-income households. So clearly this was an energy poverty measure. Well, today the situation is that before the COVID-19 crisis, France still had over 11% of households considered as energy poor. The number of homes with very low energy efficiency is estimated between 5 and 7 million. And in the last year, the National Energy Ombudsman has noticed a sharp increase by 17% of disconnections for non-payment of energy bills. So France is doing a lot of things, but still energy poverty is an issue in our country. I will talk first about energy efficiency solutions, because these are the solutions which are really addressing the core of the energy poverty problem, which is the characteristics of buildings. In that respect, the main program is a national program called Habiter Mieux. This program was initiated in 2011, and initially it was targeted towards very low income households. And over the years, it was progressively extended to more households. And so now half of the French population is eligible to that program. This program has clearly a goal of energy efficiency reduction inside the homes. Initially, the objective was to renovate the whole home. More recently, the National Habitat Agency, which is managing this program, is also funding partial renovations, and so even more households can apply to be helped by this National Habitat Agency. The specificity of that program is that from the beginning, it included a follow-up of the renovation project before it is implemented, and so the household were helped over the whole process of defining their project, finding funds, choosing a firm to do the work, etc. So this is a really interesting program. Today, over 250,000 households have benefited from it, with an acceleration in the last years. And so last year, more than 117,000 French households have benefited from it. Other energy efficiency instruments include white certificates, out of which a part is dedicated to energy poverty measures. There is also an energy transition tax credit, which has been recently transformed in a subsidy. And here the goal was clearly to make these funds also available and interesting for low-income households. And so this is really something which is being developed also in the recent period. because with the COVID crisis, now the program has been made accessible also for homeowners who are not low income. And so there is really a push toward, towards renovating homes of the whole population in France. Finally, there is a system of loans at zero rate. And so here, the idea is to finance renovations again for low-income people. And this can be used, for example, to complement, well, to, because in Habitat, in the Habiter Mieux program, people are still paying a part of the budget. And so here, zero interest loans can be used for that. And finally, there is a national program for financing the energy audits for low-income people with very inefficient homes. Again, there are a lot of other measures in the field of energy efficiency which are deployed at a more local level. In the National Energy and Climate Plan, France is mentioning these energy efficiency instruments. And besides these instruments, there is also one important element which is mentioned, which is the chèque énergie, which is an energy allowance for low-income people and protections against disconnections in winter in particular, which applies especially to low-income people. I will mainly develop this chèque énergie. This has been launched in 2018 to replace the previous social tariffs for electricity and gas, which have proven to be difficult to implement because some people were not benefiting from it for reasons of identification of the household. And so the system was simplified, and now there is a simple criteria of incomes which applies, and people will get, or people get automatically, this energy check, which allows them to pay for energy or for renovation work, so for energy efficiency measures. The average amount of this check is 150 euro per year, which has to be compared to an average energy bill of French households, which is a bit over 1,500 euros per year. Currently, 80% of people actually use it, so there are still 20% of households who are not taking up the chèque. But still, we have 5.5 million beneficiaries, so this is an important element in the French strategy against energy poverty. Following the crisis, the first phase of the COVID crisis in spring, the validity of the energy check has been extended over time to allow taking up this system, and also some protections against disconnections have been extended, and so the winter period was finished at the end of May in spring. So these are the main measures I wanted to present. Just to talk about the recent measures, I wanted to mention a plan of economic recovery, which has been announced in September. And here, the French government has announced a total budget of 100 billion euro, which will be dedicated to economic recovery, especially in the next year. And the idea is to focus this public investment on the ecological transition. And so over 6 billion euros will be dedicated especially to the refurbishment of buildings. And so a part of this will directly benefit the energy poor households, with the energy subsidy for renovations, which is increasing by 2 billion euro, and additional funds also, which would be dedicated to the renovation of social housing. So this was only the national part of the French policy approaches. Again, there are a lot of other things going on in France at the local level, at the level of associations and initiatives of people who are very dedicated to that topic of energy poverty. To conclude, however, I would say that the increase in thermal renovations is for the moment insufficient. So on two aspects. First, because for the moment it has not significantly reduced energy poverty, there has been a slight reduction in the number of very energy inefficient buildings, but still there are a lot. And regarding the climate goals, this pace of renovations clearly need to be accelerated. And so there is really a challenge in France, and when people have been discussing it and discussed a lot of possible options and developed solutions also to really achieve a change of scale of the renovation programs. In terms of challenges, the last point I want to mention is, of course, the interplay between climate goals and energy poverty reduction, which will really be an issue to which policymakers will have a very close look in the future. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Dubois. It's very interesting to see how France has tackled the energy check. I believe that in Spain we are also working in that direction, how you have addressed energy efficiency with what certificates, and how you have included all these topics in your national energy and climate plans. Afterwards, we will. Coimbra. She's a member to the Energy Initiative Board of that university, and she's also a founding member of the Portuguese Association of the Energy Economy. She works on research in the area of finance, economics, energy markets, policy design, and applications in the energy and the environment. She has participated in many competitive national and international projects developed within the domain of the economy of energy. So she will talk about how energy poverty plans are being carried out in Portugal. Thank you very much, Patricia, for joining us today. You have the
Okay, thank you. I hope everybody is hearing me correctly. Thank you for the invitation from Professor Maite, and for the opportunity to be here in an event also promoted by Netergy Foundation. So I'm going to talk very briefly about the Portuguese approach to energy poverty. First, we have to think that energy poverty lies within the field of poverty in Portugal. So just for example, when looking at electricity prices for household consumers, we can see that Portugal holds the fifth higher position in what comes to electricity prices for families. And when it comes to our income level, we are among the poorest countries in the European Union. So when talking about the main drivers of energy poverty in Portugal, we can see these two figures that show that Portugal has a mixed performance in comparison to the European average on reported indicators. For example, in 2018, almost 20% of the population reported that they were unable to keep their home adequately warm, which is notably higher than the corresponding European average of only 7.3%. Conversely, for 2018, 40.5% of the Portuguese population were unable to pay their utility bills on time due to financial difficulties, while the respective European average was higher. Portugal's performance in the household expenditure-based indicators is better than European average. The share of households that spend a high share of their income on energy expenditure is 50.1%, which is slightly lower than European average. The high energy expenditure is likely to put a strain on household budget and might indicate a poor energy efficiency of the building. Moreover, at 66.8%, Portugal has a notably lower number of households that spend a low share of their income on energy expenditure than European average. Those households might restrict their energy spending below what is really necessary to meet their energy their needs, which might be in the field of hidden energy poverty indicator that has not been accounted for in Portugal. So the performance over time has nevertheless improved in recent years, but due to the pandemic crisis, it's expected to suffer a drawback in the forthcoming months. So mainly the energy poverty has been addressed by the Portuguese Energy Agency, ADEN, a department within the Ministry of Environment and Transition Economy. It has been mainly addressed through the financial assistance via the social tariff. It started by a decree law in 2010, but it had begun 2 years in advance. Since 2016, the tariff is automatically awarded to vulnerable consumers receiving certain social benefits and to low-income households. I made part of a small team that was commissioned with a full report on the assessment of the implementation of the social tariff in Portugal, and it's available at this link that you can see on the screen. The Portuguese Energy Agency, ADEN, that runs a project on energy poverty and energy efficiency. Not many years ago, and this is something that is to highlight, Portugal is not is far from being in the forefront of the European member states when it comes to delivering very effective measures towards energy poverty. But nevertheless, it has some selected measures. We have a long tradition of promotion of efficiency in electric energy consumption. We have the social tariff, and also we have the energy efficiency fund. So some milestones in the definition and implementation of the social tariff are to highlight. The first decree law dates from 2010 when it comes to electricity, and when it comes to natural gas, it was 1 year later. We, in the beginning of this measure, in the application of this measure, it was up to the beneficiaries to request their adhesion and to become real beneficiaries of the measure. Only in 2016, the way things were done became really effective because of the automaticity procedure. This even led to make the Portuguese Administrative Association to win an European prize. Families need to be under certain criteria. They have to be either under the solidary supplement for the elderly, to benefit from an income support supplement, to to be holders of an unemployment social benefit, to be in the first block of a family allowance, that is the child benefit in Portugal, to have a social disability pension or a social pension for old age. So that automatic procedure is an interface between several institutions in Portugal. The one that is dedicated mostly to this issue is the Directorate General for Energy and Geology, DGEG. And it has to exchange information and to verify the information through the tax authority and the social security authority. We also have interactions between the electricity service providers and also the natural gas service providers. So we can see it's quite obvious that in the beginning, and due to the low level of energy illiteracy that runs in the country, and I believe it's not just a Portuguese reality, it's something that is transversal to many other countries in Europe. Once we became we moved to the automaticity scheme, the prevalence of social tariffs reached an impressive number of beneficiaries, and we can also see from this map that the highest number of beneficiaries are up in the north of Portugal for two main specific reasons. It's the most populated region in the country. It's where it's the weather conditions are worse, where the building stock is older, and also where there are many, many poor regions and poor districts and very low income households. The same applies to the natural gas infrastructure, although here we have to highlight that in the interior, families still use bottled natural gas, bottled gas, so the number of beneficiaries is not really is not revealing the reality of the country. When it comes to the eligibility criteria, and when we made the study, it became quite evident that the income level was the major driver of being eligible to benefit from a social tariff. Also, we know that in the to have a rigorous characterization of the profile of the profile of the social tariff beneficiaries, it lacks a microeconomic information to analyze the typology of households and their socioeconomic conditions. The unavailability of data with microeconomic breakdowns limits the analysis of the profile of the beneficiaries. But nevertheless, it can be seen that more than half of them is due to the compliance within the income criteria. Furthermore, the financing, we know that the percentage of families with an energy affordability ratio higher than the 10% threshold shows that the averages do not reveal the real dimension of the problem of affordability to energy services by Portuguese families. With the exceptions of the regions of the Lisbon metropolitan areas, that you can see here, the third column in this graph, and also in the Algarve, there are more than 20% of families which burden the energy services accounts for more than 10% of the household's budget in all the other regions of the country. Uh, In general, we know that a reduction in that ratio is evident when the social tariff is applied, which is most evident in the case of electricity, falling between 2 and 3 percentage points depending on the sub-criteria. In this table, we made an exercise of two scenarios corresponding to two types of households that are considered for each of the energy services. To calculate the charges, we use the social tariff comparator of the energy saving portal called Poupa Energia, Save Energy in English. In the case of electricity, in scenario one, the hypotheses considered were as follows: contracted power of 3.45 kVAs, simple tariff, paper invoice, payment, a specific type of payment. And in scenario two, the contracted power is the traditional 6.1 kVAs with bi-hourly rate, also the same type of pay shop payment. We know that when it comes to the financial costs, the impact in Portugal, unlike what is happening in Spain, for example, the burden is on the production, on the generator companies. The top three generators in Portugal, EDP, Turbogás, and Endesa, account for 90% of the social tariff contribution. Currently, they are now, EDP has just publicly announced that is asking the government to move from having this burden from the generator's side to the supplier side, as I believe it's what is happened has happened in Spain. So the impact of energy poverty, and this is a graph that relates, that is was redrawn from the European Union survey. We know that the percentage of unable population to keep their home adequately warm has been improving, as well as the population with arrears on utility bills, and also the population living in a dwelling with leaking roof, damp walls, floors, or foundation, or rotting window or floor. So to conclude, we know that the social tariff was a relevant and is still a relevant measure to guarantee the universal access to energy services. Its application is still justified for affordability reasons and due to the significant proportion of beneficiaries in the universe of domestic consumers. We have to notice that around 800,000 beneficiaries in a universe of 6 million is a lot, is almost one-fifth of the population that is entitled to receive the social tariff. This is the consequence of Portugal being a poor country, not only energy poor. And we know that the introduction of the automaticity mechanism was highly successful because it increased the number of recipients and it helped families that were completely energy illiterate to benefit from this measure. Nevertheless, we have to recognize that this social tariff has a small impact on energy poverty. To go further on this area, targeted structural measures like energy renovations, energy efficiency measures, retrofitting measures provide lasting solution. Portugal is still in the process of of developing its long-term strategy to combat energy poverty and is therefore still determining the monitoring indicators, strategies, and targets that would most adequately address household needs. We need to combine economic measures with energy efficiency measures. And as we have all heard from the beginning of this webinar, Portugal has not yet defined a definition for energy poverty, which is a crucial step to have the implementation of specific measures. So we can get back to this issue later on if you wish.
Muchas gracias, Patricia, por tu intervención.
Thank you very much, Patricia, for your presentation. It's interesting to see how Portugal has tackled the issue of access to data by automating procedures, even though, as you have just said, social tariffs are a short-term solution. Now, energy efficiency measures should be implemented in the long term in order to provide a medium and long term solution. So thank you very much, Patricia, for your presentation. Finally, we are going to connect with Professor Darren McCoy from the UK. He is a researcher at the Grantham Research Institute on Climate Change and the Environment. His research work is mainly focused on empirical aspects with the use of control and random systems and the analysis of data in order to determine decarbonization and energy reduction. So his research work involves close collaboration with energy companies and government authorities. Right now, he is researching on long-term impact of energy efficiency actions, the adoption of technologies in households, a very important aspect, also energy poverty, and the design and assessment of energy policies. Thank you very much, Professor McCoy, for joining us today. You have the floor.
Thank you for the kind introduction. And to the Chair of Energy Sustainability for inviting me to come and talk to you today. I'm going to talk mainly about the UK, mainly about England, but I'll also touch on some of the other devolved administrations in Scotland, Northern Ireland, and Wales. As touched on by some presenters previously, that the first point I want to make is that the UK has a very long history of both academic research and policy initiatives focusing on energy poverty, going back to at least the 1980s, evidenced by this very nice figure recently published in Energy Research and Social Science by Mahoney and other authors. So I guess one of the key points to make from this graph has been the development of metrics. So Brenda Boardman's work in the early 1991, developing the 10% metric. Following that, there was a lot of activity. And more recently in 2012, following the Hills review, there was an update and the low income, high cost metric was adopted for policy purposes in the UK or in England primarily. So, after such a developed history of looking at the problem, where are we now? Well, UK energy consumption of space heating per meter squared has been falling in recent years. And, looking at the low income, high cost measure in England, fuel poverty has been broadly somewhere in or around 10% over the last number of years, ranging from 8% in the southwest up to 12% up in the northwest, where obviously you have colder winters and worse weather conditions. So on the face of it, things have been quite stable, but this masks a lot of internal variability, both in the metrics that are being used, in the approaches that are being undertaken by the administrations, and in the the appropriate policy responses as a result. So just to illustrate this point, taking again a table from Mahoney et al., I just demonstrate the percentage of fuel poor households using different metrics in each of the various countries. So, and you can see, you know, England, the variation between the low income, high cost measure and the 10% measure. And in some cases, these differences can be quite substantial. And very interestingly, so some recent work by Stefan and colleagues at the University of Manchester. So the data is from a few years back, but essentially what the maps on the right illustrate is that, you know, the spatial distribution of the problem is quite different depending on which measure you use, and highlighting differences in housing costs and urban-rural divides. So I guess, you know, the point I'm trying to make here is that the appropriate policy response can be quite different depending on what measure you consider. And we know that fuel poverty is a very complex phenomenon, and it is quite difficult to characterize using, you know, quite specific metrics that all have their own limitations. In terms of the policy response, there are many ongoing responses ranging from income supports, the energy company obligations, a number of some subsidies, you know, advice, standards, various fuel poverty targets. I'm not going to say too much in the interest of time about this table here, but to maybe summarize some highlights. So you know, that the primary policy mechanism for energy efficiency in the UK since the early 2000s has been the energy company obligation in various guises. And essentially, this is a market-based instrument that places obligations on the suppliers to install certain targets of energy efficiency measures. Now, there has typically been a priority group target within each policy. And more recently, funding has been cut significantly, but the policy has been repurposed to specifically target fuel poor households. But there has been problems in targeting the right people. So, you know, the use of certain metrics has made it quite difficult to target certain individuals who are very needy. The government have tried different types of flexible eligibility in order to try to overcome this problem. But a key issue has been the fact that eligibility is linked to the benefit system. And this can place quite a heavy administrative burden sometimes on households in order to demonstrate that they're eligible for certain schemes. This has been complemented with income supports since 1986, various income supports supporting elderly households and essentially fuel poor households. But again, and this is probably in terms of the financial support is I think three times in excess of the energy company obligation currently, but it's been shown that this tends to poorly target those households that are in fuel poverty also. There have been some subsidy schemes, the Warm Front grant scheme, which ran for a number of years, which had a high level of uptake and generally positive reviews, but due to funding it was ended in 2013. So over recent years, as I mentioned, the scope of ECO has been reduced. Some targets have been missed, particularly around upgrading the building stock. And there has been a significant focus on the energy price cap, with Ofgem, the regulator, implementing an energy price cap on standard variable tariffs within the UK energy market. And this was partly because of households just not switching. So households were remaining on high tariffs and not switching due to concerns over competition in the market. So there's been a big initiative to try to encourage households to switch, but also to restrict billing for those households that don't switch. There have been some high-profile policy failures in terms of the Green Deal, which was a loan-based instrument to try to encourage energy efficiency. And that had, you know, much lower uptake than was expected. The high interest rates were one of the reasons that were cited. And recently, there's been a lot of focus on smart metering. So it's the largest energy efficiency or energy demand side policy initiative in the UK has been focused on the smart metering implementation program. You know, in terms of fuel poverty in the National Energy and Climate Plans, so there has been renewed ambition in terms of energy efficiency, but I would argue that energy poverty is not a priority within these plans, and it's subsumed within broader energy efficiency targets and targets regarding the internal energy market in the UK. And I'm just going to finish with two final points kind of looking ahead, thinking firstly in the short term, you know, COVID-19 pandemic has had a big impact in terms of people spending more time at home. National Energy Action produced some recent work looking at this issue. People spending more time at home, restrictions in income, you know, is likely to increase energy rationing and energy debt. And then thinking about the long term, you know, some work produced by Josh Burke and other colleagues of mine at the Grantham Institute has looked at the burden of proposed carbon taxes for various income deciles in 2030. And what we can see is that without appropriate revenue recycling mechanisms, you know, policy costs, you know, carbon prices are going to disproportionately fall on low income households. So, you know, this is just something that we need to be very aware of in the longer term as we, you know, apply increasingly expensive climate policies. We need to think about you know, revenue recycling and other types of mechanisms. So I'll stop there and thank you very much for the opportunity to speak.
Professor McCoy, thank you to all speakers for using just the time allotted to them. It's been very interesting to get your insights into your countries. I would like to remind those of you who are accompanying us today that both this webinar and that report will be available on the Naturgy Foundation's website. We have some questions about the future and the national plans, but unfortunately we are well over time, and to be respectful to those of you who are connected, more than 200 people, we will once again extend our appreciation to our speakers for having shared their perspectives with us, and we will turn to Barcelona for some closing remarks. Once again, thank you all. Thank you very much, Esther. And once again, thank you very much to all our keynote speakers today. Next, we are going to have our closing ceremony. I would like to, first of all, thank Ms. Katarina Sico, Director of Internal Energy Market at the Directorate General of Energy of the European Commission. Unfortunately, she was not able to join us today, but she prepared a video for us.
Ladies and gentlemen, many thanks to the Chair of Energy Sustainability at the University of Barcelona for the opportunity to close the webinar that aims to explore energy poverty across Europe. I want to take this opportunity to thank Stefan Buzarowski, who is among us as speaker today, for his dedication as former chair to the Energy Poverty Observatory. The Observatory demonstrates that EU's commitment to tackling energy poverty by its roots has become a reference source for member states to consult when designing their energy poverty policies and measures. Referring to the Chair's work and Naturgy's support, it is crucial to underline the fundamental contribution of academic research on the production, supply, and use of the energy needed to maintain social welfare and development. Energy poverty, in particular, is a complex and delicate phenomenon to measure and address. In light of the Commission's focus now on the Green Deal and the guiding principle that no one is left behind in the energy transition towards a green, digital, and just economy, it is encouraging to see and to take part in such active stakeholder engagement around this topic. As the full consequences of the COVID-19 pandemic emerge, so does the opportunity to commit to our just transition objectives. Indeed, the pandemic accentuates the pressure and the need to guarantee access to affordable, reliable, sustainable, and modern energy for all Europeans. We need to develop strategies on the basis that access to essential energy services is among the 20 key principles of the European pillar of social rights. The effect of energy transition on energy poverty is complex and depends on a combination of low income, high expenditure of disposable income on energy, and poor energy efficiency, especially as regards the performance of buildings. As a way of concluding today's series of talks, let me run you through the current EU policies and available EU support that help address energy poverty. To begin with, I'd like to mention the strong link that exists between energy poverty and the green energy targets. Addressing the structural causes of energy poverty and notably the energy inefficiency of homes can make an important contribution to reaching the energy targets. And the clean energy package, fully adopted by June 2019, is all about reaching the energy targets. But it is also a breakthrough legislative package in the way it has elevated the protection of vulnerable consumers and the fight against energy poverty in the EU agenda of policy priorities. However, structural solutions of a certain nature won't do for all member states. Indeed, it is impossible to provide a one-size-fits-all remedy to energy poverty across Europe. This is why social policy must act where needed during the transition, and it must act in a way that complements other policies. As I hope most of you would agree, as followers of the EU energy policy, the Commission has been busy trying to better understand the levels of energy poverty across Europe and what causes energy poverty to be particularly high in certain areas. We strive to help accelerate local solutions as much as possible, and the Green Deal has undeniably provided a timely momentum for this. Last October, the Commission decided on pushing forward a renovation wave, which includes also an energy poverty recommendation. This energy poverty recommendation and its accompanying staff working document provides further guidance to member states as to how to define and monitor energy poverty and help spread best practices. While the recommendation provides general recommendations for all member states, the guidance document is more about presenting energy poverty varying in different national situations by looking at different indicators and in identifying best practices and showing what support is available at the EU level. Both documents are developed on the basis of the information received from member states via the national energy and climate plans. These plans, of course, are fundamental tools whereby member states looks into how to address energy poverty at home. We have made our assessments available for member states, which additionally contribute to evolution of energy poverty conceptions and measures to be taken. Importantly, the energy poverty recommendation suggests the consultation of a list of aggregate indicators developed at European level. These may help look at national specificities, and a better identification of these national specificities has been demonstrated to enable mutual learning and exchange of best practice. There are a couple of recommendations to member states that I would like to highlight here. So first, we call for an increased reliance on energy service companies and energy performance contracts to renovate social housing. It is very important, this role of current and new energy communities, social enterprises, and the collaboration of the public sector with civil society organizations working at grassroots level. And it is fundamental that more public solutions cooperate with private initiatives. Housing associations are also deemed relevant should benefit from capacity building. And here the spotlight strategy, the renovation wave, comes clear into the picture. Renovation is a huge opportunity for the 34 million Europeans who are unable to afford keeping their homes adequate, adequately warm in the winter. And each year, 800,000 social homes need renovation. This is why tackling energy poverty and the worst performing buildings is one of the three focus areas in the renovation wave. In light of all this, there is a need to refer to the recovery and resilience facility that the Commission has proposed and the importance of the priority flagship Renovate as one of the key parts of this recovery facility. The Commission is equipped to steer member states where possible to include the necessary renovation measures to tackle energy poverty in the recovery plans. And these plans need to interact with the national energy and climate plans. In addition, we continue to support several platforms, namely the EU Energy Poverty Observatory, the Covenant of Mayors that works with more than 10,000 cities across the EU, or the Horizon Europe Mission on Cities. These platforms are well equipped to monitor energy poverty across Europe, in addition to, for instance, Gold Regions in Transition and the Clean Energy Islands initiative that have been launched more recently. I hope this rapid overview gives you a good idea on what is possible, what tools, what criteria, what indicators can be used, and also on how the Commission provides support for fighting against energy poverty. So I will encourage you all then to look at the energy poverty recommendation, dive into the renovation wave and the national plans, and work together with your local and national authorities in making the energy poverty removed. To conclude, I would like to reiterate my gratitude to the University of Barcelona and Naturgy Foundation for this very successful webinar and all the fruitful discussions that it has have taken place today, and that will continue inspiring the academics and the wider energy poverty community. So many thanks to listening to you, and I wish you all the success in your future research and energy poverty solutions. And I look forward to seeing you all in real in Barcelona or elsewhere very soon. Many thanks.
Thank you very much, Ms. Katarina. We hope that indeed we can meet in person soon, and I'm sure that after everything that you have shared with us, we will have plenty of material to continue preparing for the webinars. Well, in closing to this webinar, now I would like to turn to Rafael Villasecas, who is the president of the Naturgy Foundation, in order to address the floor.
Thank you, Mario Eugenia. Good day, everyone. First of all, please allow me to thank you for watching us and connecting to this webinar that we're organizing for the third time regarding this important topic. So I'd like to especially thank the participation in the webinar of Stefan Wuzarowski and Katarina Siko. I thank them especially, and I'd like to thank the work of Dr. Maria Teresa Campi Costa, and we're really grateful to her for organizing this seminar with her team, because for the third time we have been able to raise the interest of all of you. It is quite a cliche to talk about the crisis. We've been in crisis in plural for a long time. However, we shouldn't stop thinking on the often serious and social and dramatic consequences of these crises. And in particular, energy poverty is one of those consequences. It is, and it has been, the object of many governments, administrations, companies and social organizations that try, just like we do, to identify it, get to know it, treat it, and alleviate it. It's a very important problem, as all research shows, and no doubt it's a complex problem, requiring a lot of detail to get to know its scope, the way to approach it. And it also requires knowledge to solve it effectively and efficiently. And we don't always achieve that because the problem is quite complex, I repeat. And one of the foundation's pillars is to act in relation to energy. And this is the third time that with the collaboration of Maria Teresa Costa and her team, we're dealing with this topic to shed some light and give solutions to energy poverty. We developed a seminar on the causes and proposals of this issue. That was the first one. The second one, we gave a detailed analysis from the income perspective. And this is the third webinar, a analysis, a research of the approach on the topic by the closest countries to us. Is a very serious problem, and it is estimated that in Europe it affects 50 million homes. It's quite an important topic, and shedding some light on this topic will allow us to be much more effective and specific to fight against this problem, which is one of the areas of the social impact of this crisis, and our foundation aims to help in this matter. Our foundation has been working for a long time with these webinars and publications and pieces of research that aim to shed light on the topic. And we have done so in different ways. First of all, helping building renovations and home retrofitting to allow us to reduce the effect of energy on household bills. Secondly, training people so that their consumption may be more efficient. And thirdly, through energy volunteering. There are actually people that with our help and assistance collaborate with families that need protection and help. That, together with the promotion of research like the one we're dealing with today, is one of our main tasks. And that has allowed us to help more than 110,000 homes in the fight against energy poverty. The aim is to get into the details, to be specific, and to help organize and help coordinate the efforts in this relevant matter. I'd just like to thank everyone who's connected for the interest that they're showing, that makes us also interested in advancing. I'd like to thank the interest of all participants, and once again I thank them. And finally, I'd like to greet you all goodbye until our next webinar, hoping to keep your interest so that our work and our efforts on this field will be rewarded by your understanding and your collaboration with all of us and with the programs and webinars we hold. Thank you very much. Have a lovely weekend and see you next time. Thank you.